Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, thank you for this nation. Father, I thank you, oh God, for a great revival, a great outpouring of your Holy Spirit. We thank you, Father, that the anointing of your Holy Spirit falls upon the houses of the people who have come to be called by your name. It falls upon the churches of all that all those folks in those houses go to. Father, we thank you for a mighty outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Father, we thank you, Lord, that every person will come to understand that when your church begins to move in authority and faith, that everything has to conform to your will and to your plan. So we pray, Father, that no one will feel insignificant when you've made us so significant. Hallelujah. I mean, how can you be insignificant when the Father said, whatever you ask him, he'll do it? You can be sitting in, you know, in the middle of nowhere asking the Father to do things, changing all the world, subduing nations, just because you asked. Come on, Menemangalim. I don't want a bunch of listening heads tonight. I want a bunch of listening spirits and hearts. I want you to hook up with the Holy Ghost. I want you to hook up with the realms of the Spirit. Hallelujah. We want you to listen with your heart tonight, not your head. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, you can listen with your head too, you know. You can have an understanding. Praise God for that. But I wouldn't rely too much on your own memory when you've got the remembrance. Amen. Hallelujah. Nobody's memory, I don't care if they've got a perfect, total recall, perfect photographic memory, can match the wisdom that the Lord gives by the Holy Spirit to those who know how to speak by the Spirit, who take no thought for what they're going to say, but totally entrust themselves to that which the Spirit of the Lord will speak through them with the Spirit of the Father. You have to see you have the Spirit of the Father. Did you know the Scripture says you have the Spirit of the Father? Come on now. I got four nods and 55 stares. Okay, I don't want a bunch of eyes looking at me. Come on now. Come on. You just don't know? That's why you can't say it? Let me just inform you tonight so you know from here on out. The Scripture says you have the Spirit of the Father. Amen. So now you know it, don't you? Amen. You could have said, well, we didn't know it before, Pastor, but now we know it now. I don't know how you could be around here very long and not know that you have the Spirit of the Father. Hallelujah. Did you know that you have the Spirit of the Son? Yeah. Well, everybody knows that, seems. I mean, I'm not looking for loud, honestly. I'm not looking for loud. I'm not deaf. I'm not hard of hearing. You know, we're looking for response. We're just looking for you to hook up with the anointing, looking for you to hook up with faith. Many times we'll start talking to people and say, okay, tell us what's wrong with you. Tell us what's going on in your life. You know, if my dear, sweet, wonderful wife, which is an amazing blessing beyond anything that I can tell you, if she comes to me with an issue with a problem, I'll start talking to her because I want to hook up in faith with her. If I noticed any doubt, I'll just say, baby, you know what? You know, that's doubt and unbelief. We're going to have to move that aside so we can step over here and begin to agree with Father. Because it's not about you agreeing with me. It's not about me agreeing with you. It's about us agreeing with God. If we agree with Father, then he's going to ultimately give to us those things that we find ourselves in need of. We're a little bit overcome, overwhelmed. And really, the only reason to talk about anything is because there's a solution. Who wants to talk about a problem just to be that much deeper, embedded in the problem? I don't want to talk about any problems. You want to talk about problems? No. It's depressing to talk about problems.
It's very depressing.
I want to talk about solutions. Amen. We can talk about answers.
Amen.
Yeah, the problems. We'll just get to the answer real quick. Just jump to the answer. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 So I better begin to talk with people. I just begin asking questions because I want to hook up with the faith. I don't want to hook up with their doubt. Well, I'm not going to hook up with the doubt. And what the reality of it is, we're not going to get anywhere here. I've got faith, you got doubt, and you're trying to agree. It ain't going to work. And so we'll begin to talk to you like this. We want you to understand what you have and who you are. We want you to begin to believe the things that God has given a report of you and what he's described and what he's declared. Listen, you have to understand. You have given too many things authority in your life. You've given finances authority in your life. You shouldn't have done it. You call it rational thinking, responsibility. No, it's not. Responsibility is obeying God, realizing he'll supply all that you have need of according to his riches and glory. That's responsibility, to believe what God has to say. That's the right kind of thinking. That's the right way of living. And, you know, you can put Father to the test. He says, prove me. He says, see what I'll do when you begin to obey me and trust me in the realms of finances. That's Father's way. Father said, told us, take no thought for what you should wear. Take no thought for what you shall eat. People take thought of it all the time. Within the framework of worrying about it, being concerned about it. Oh, we've got to make this happen for ourselves. I mean, we're going to all take thought of it, praise God. You know, that we have to eat, otherwise we're going to die. But we know we don't have to take thought of it in respect of worrying or be concerned about it, because we know He's going to provide. And then the Lord has the right to try you. Did you know that? And He's going to try you and test you. You say, oh, Lord God, you do anything you want to do with me. And He says, that's great, wonderful. And then the next day, you know, He says, we're going to go ahead and get this underway, you know, because we're going to have to go ahead and light the fire to the thing. Yeah. Amen. Because the furnace is for the silver. The refiner's pot for the tin or for the gold, but the Lord tries the heart. And then all of a sudden, the situation, the circumstance going down. People are ignorant. They don't know the ways of God. They don't know how to rely upon God. They don't know how to trust the Lord. Huh? Abraham had learned how to trust the Father. And the Lord's good. He's merciful. He gently leads us. He's amazing. Look at how He gently led Abraham. I thought it was pretty radical, you know. Certainly the first step that we see God take Abraham into was definitely a radical step when He says, listen, I want you to leave your home, your job. I want you to leave everything. I want you to pack up right now, and I want you to go somewhere. And he says to the pastor, hey, the Lord told me to go somewhere. Well, where did He say to go? He didn't say. He just said somewhere. So Abraham went out not knowing where he was going. Hallelujah. But understand what he was going after. He was going and he's going in search of the kingdom. He was in search of a city that hath foundations. Are you in search of a city? Are you in search of things? You think that whatever's going on in your life right now is really going to mitigate your pain and mitigate your sorrow and mitigate your issues? It's not. You might as well just go ahead and learn the lesson right now. It ain't going to help you at all. You've given authority to too many things in your life. You've given authority to circumstances. You've given authority where it doesn't belong, where people will try to make you insignificant, talk down to you, bosses who will just utilize you for their own purpose and for their own gain. You've given authority to demon spirits, to lies, to doctrines, to devils, to philosophies, to ideologies. It's time to give all authority to Jesus Christ. He said, it's all mine. Amen. He said, all authority is given to me in heaven and earth. He said, I've been given it. Father said He gave Jesus a name that is above every name. He set Him above all principality and power and might and dominion, everything, everything. Now listen to me, everything. You don't have it. Listen, everything. Not some things, everything. When you get this, you're not going to be having a place for the devil in your life anymore. People have given ownership to the devil in their life. Did you know that? Well, there's some part of me that's still not redeemed. There's some part of me, you know, this Satan still has a hold on. Man, you want to give all authority to Christ Jesus. You give no authority, no dominion of any form of sin. See, the scripture says, sin shall have no more dominion over you. Well, why give it then? Why give it by, you know, really, the Lord has put so much of our interaction, our relationship with Him in terms of our dialogue, on our conversation, and what we say, and what we ask, and what we declare. We don't understand it. We think, you know, people have gotten to the place where words are just meaningless and they're idle. No, they're not. Your words are very important. The things that you vow to do, the things that you promise to do, the things that you declare that you're going to do. When you make a promise to someone or you say you're going to do something, you're supposed to follow through on that. Father demands it. He follows through on everything that He's spoken. His word's not left up to, you know, wonder whether or not it's going to take place. It's forever settled in heaven. He's going to do it. He's faithful. He wants to teach us how to be faithful. Words are very valuable. They're very important. It's by the means of God's spoken word, hallelujah, that He framed the heavens. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the name of Jesus. Get this stuff out of it. People give sickness authority over the life. Well, sickness has authority over my life. No, it doesn't. Jesus is the healer. You know this. You know this room's filled with heaven right now? If your eyes could be open, you could see some marvelous things taking place here right now. Believe me. Father wants to do that. He wants to cause you to live more in heaven, to speak out of heaven, than to live in earth. He wants your heart to be in heaven. He wants your conversation to be in heaven. That's what Paul said to the Philippians. Your conversation is now in heaven. The Lord has told us that by Paul, when Paul spoke to the church at Ephesus, you're seated in the heavenly realm. Hallelujah. He told the church at Colossae, you've been translated from the kingdoms of this world into the kingdom of the dear Son. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to get in heaven. You get in heaven, you'll see things different. You'll speak to things different. You'll have authority. You won't worry about the Obama administration. But, and he's just being told what to do by and large, by, you know, this system and situation. But I'm going to tell you right now, listen to me. The old timers in Congress or the Senate, doesn't matter. It doesn't even matter. They not look, God's in charge. His church is in charge. We the ones who empower that. I mean, we're going to have to understand the authority that we're under is the authority that is greater than any authority in the realms of this world. And we can change every situation and everything. Should we begin to believe differently? Should we begin to believe what God says concerning us? Should we stop giving the wrong authority over to the powers of darkness, over to opinions, over to ideologies and philosophies, and begin to live by the Word, because that's empowering. That's His Word is up. His Word is living and powerful, His Spirit and His life. It's the authority that framed the heavens. And He's put His Word in our mouth and in our heart, and the Word of faith, which we now are able to declare and speak. And when we speak it, devils have to leave in His name. When we speak it, we lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. People give too much authority to things. They give authority to sickness. They give authority to disease. They give authority to sin. They give authority to iniquity. They give authority to the powers of darkness. They give authority to governments. The Father's given us power to bring down those authorities, to cast down every high thing. Hallelujah. Did you know that you have the Spirit of the Holy Spirit?
Yes,
I do. Let's look at this. You have the Spirit of the Father. What happened with Joseph? And he had just the Spirit of God in him. I mean, didn't say he had the Spirit of the Father, Spirit of the Son, Spirit of the Holy Spirit. He just had the Spirit of the living God in him. And whom is the Spirit of God? That's what they said about Joseph. That's what they said about Daniel. Look, come on, dear people. Father wants to give you and me a wisdom that no one can find fault with, nor can they resist. You're just going to have to stop speaking your own stuff and living your life according to your own dictates, to your own ideologies, to what you think. Come on, people, listen to me. If we could just have a moment of rational thinking, if we could have just a moment to calm down and recognize that God has declared to us how it is in His Word, He's revealed everything about that which we need to know to be successfully be successful representatives of Him in this earth, in His Word. And yet we're going to go and live out our own life and try to do it our own way. Come on. You can have a prayer meeting and you say, oh, Lord, come change this situation, because all of a sudden you find yourself in a fix and you're desperate. Oh, God, go, God, come right now. But you know what? And He may, depending on whether or not you in rebellion or whether or not you've just found yourself in a situation by your own, ignorance and disobedience, He may answer. Then again, He may say, I told you what to do already. And a lot of people can't hear, I told you what to do. Huh? They want God, go ahead, oh, get me out of this situation. He wants you to repent. Because He told you what to do. He told you how to behave. He told you how to rely on Him. He told you what to speak. He told you how to act. And you didn't want to do it. And now you want Him to come get you out of the trouble you got yourself into. Oh, God, the devil. The devil didn't do it. You did it. It was disobedience that did it. The best thing that you need to do is when you find yourself in trouble, repent. Say, Lord, forgive me. Father, I ask you right now if there's anything that I've done that is, just shine your floodlight of heaven upon my soul right now. If there's anything that I've done, any misstep that I've taken, I want you to show me right now. You know, we find ourselves sometimes in situations and we begin to pray and we don't sense the movings of God, and we'll just back up just a minute and say, Lord, shine the floodlight of heaven. Then we don't have to make anything up, because we got a relationship with the Holy Ghost and He's going to talk to us. He's going to say, look, and He's going to show us something that is very specific. Well, I told you to do this and you didn't do it. Oh, Father, forgive me. And I want you to get into this kind of relationship with the Lord. Oh, God, forgive me. I'm sorry for disobeying you. I repent right now, and I ask you, Father, in the name of Jesus, wash that away. cleanse that by your mighty power and by your love and your by your grace, and strengthen me right now to do it, because I'm tired of living in the belly's well, the well's belly. I'm tired of living in the well's belly, huh? I went out of here. It smells in here, huh? Huh? I went down to the bottoms of the earth, the places of the people of the past. I cried unto the Lord, and He heard me out of the depths of hell. Hallelujah. He repented. He said, listen, you know, get me out of here so I can go on to Tarshish. He said, get me out of here, I'll head to Nineveh.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. It's amazing sometimes how the world has more discernment about the wrongdoing of the men and women of God than the men and women of God do. Men and women of God hiding. Huh? They cast lots and it fell on Jonah. They cast lots, said, who's the problem child around here, you know? Everybody call upon your gods. They come and we find Jonah. What's he doing? Sleeping. Oh, sleeper, what are you doing? There must be something seriously wrong with you. We're all calling on our gods so that we can be saved from the storm, and here you are sleeping. That prophet. Well, bless his heart, he really knew what the remedy was. They just throw me overboard. He was an interesting guy. I guess he was just ready for heaven. I guess he just had an eternal security doctrine or something. I don't know, man. He didn't care whether the boat floated or sunk. He went to sleep. And I don't know. Who Jonah? He says he's a mystery to me. The doctrine of Jonah is really interesting. One thing for sure is, people, you're not going to move forward with God when you've allowed things that are disobedience, when you've given wrong attitudes, authority over your life to tell you what to do, to dictate to you, wrong relationships to dictate to you. Tonight, we just want the floodlight of heaven to shine upon your soul. We want the glory of God to so overwhelm you so that you can begin to see all the good things that God has done for you. He's not made you insignificant. He's not relegated you to some lower class position in the kingdom of God. He's empowered every person. He's just saying, will you just live it? Will you begin to believe that the Spirit of the Father is on the inside of you? Spirit of the Father is on the inside of you for you to get up every morning and prophesy to yourself. I want to see you start prophesying yourself. Amen. Amen.
That's good.
Hallelujah. Spirit of the Son's on the inside of you so you can speak wisdom to yourself every morning when you get up out of bed. Declare to yourself what you're going to do with your life. Huh? And if you get up out in the morning, you find yourself grumpy, then you need to strongly rebuke yourself in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. You find anything going on in your life that doesn't look like the love of God and the goodness of God and the mercy of God, hallelujah. The joy of the Lord, rebuke yourself. Say, you just rebuke yourself for coming under the wrong influence. Huh? Hormones have an influence. They have the right to rule your being. No right to rule you. Paul said, I beat under my body and I keep it in submission, lest I, being a preacher of the gospel, should end up as a castaway. No right to rule you. I'm telling you right now, I heard preachers preach on this when I was a little guy. Listen, just talking to the men and to the women, especially the women. Say, women, I'll tell you right now, I'll save you a whole lot of problems later on in life. Don't let hormones rule your body, rule your being. They're there for just purposes and divine order and divine cause, but they don't have to. If it comes to the place where it's affecting your emotions, there's something wrong with you. You're coming under the influence of wrong power. You got to rise up and say, wait a minute, this doesn't meet the criteria of what God said. This isn't joy. This isn't love. This isn't goodness. This isn't gentleness. This isn't meekness. This isn't right feeling. This isn't right attitude. I'm not going to come under depression. I'm not going to come under some kind of grumpiness.
Amen.
Or whatever.
Amen.
The grumpiness is not as... I feel that I need to go everywhere and teach people that grumpiness is not a fruit of the Spirit. Because I just feel that most people have somehow mistaken that sadness and sorrow and grumpiness, huh, and pain and woundedness and hurt is fruit of the Spirit. No. No, it's not a fruit of the Spirit. It isn't. As the devil. Not necessarily. It might just be 100% unadulterated, genuinely you. You and you and nobody else but you. You, yourself, and you. Hallelujah. What happens if you say, I'm not living this way no more? I'm not going to let these things have authority over my life. I'm not going to let this situation dictate a behavior, an attitude, a way of thinking, a way of acting, a way of believing. I'm not letting this stuff dictate anything to me. God promised a blessing upon me. And all I've got to do is come under His rule and His authority. All I've got to recognize what He's done for me, who He is in me, and begin to rely on Him. All I'm going to do is begin to go through the thing. I've found over and again, if I just sit down and I just rehearse all the things that God has done for me, I just rehearse His word. I mean, Ann and I have been in some crisis situations in foreign countries where it looked very bleak. Oh, you know what we did? Hurry, call 911. There was no 911. Oh, run to the American embassy. It's too far away. Where's your insurance card? They don't have them here. And there's nothing but Jesus. There's no one to rely on but God. And we just sit down and we begin to minister to ourselves and just talk about how faithful He's been, all the things that He did, and the miracles that took us to get here. You know, we eliminate all the obstacles. We make all the obstacles disappear. Because all we were willing to look at and all we're willing to focus on is all the events that God has wrought for us, all the miracles that He has brought to pass. We bring into remembrance how faithful He has been in our life, how He's upheld us. I'm going to tell you right now, dear people, every day God is supplying great provision for you. The problem is that most folks don't even recognize it. And then the more you'll begin to move in God and step out beyond your own human ability, beyond your own financial ability, beyond your own physical ability, the more profound all that He's been doing all the time becomes to you. If we can just rehearse these things, say, I have the Spirit of the Father. What am I concerned about with respect to giving an answer to those who require a explanation of who I am in God or what I'm doing? Why do I need to go and look for some expert to give me instruction in the areas of my business or the areas of my concern or the area of my need or the area of my interest, when I have the Spirit of the Father here, when I have the Spirit of the Son here, when I have the Spirit of the Holy Spirit, when I have counsel here, I have wisdom here, I have instruction here, I have might here, I have understanding here. All I need to do is be able to hook up with that realm, that flow, that dimension of divine power and authority that sometimes it seems like is very aloof to people. They just think, well, the Bible said it, and it's so, and now all I must do is confess it with my mouth, and it's done. Well, you know what? There's a part truth to that. It's more than just something that's going on with your mouth, though. It's something that's going on in your heart at the same time. It's something that's going on inside of you. I mean, something that's going on in your heart is something that you really are certain of. You know it. You feel it. It's real to you. You're listening to me. Listen, Father wants to cause you to realize that you were made a new creation, not a half creation, not a kind of new creation. Not now you once were all belonging to Satan, now you're half holy and half unholy. Now you're half good and half evil. Now you are like a can with a bunch of worms on the inside of it. Keep the lid on and the worms won't come out. What a doctrine is this? The doctrine of worms. Oh, sin that dwelleth in me. If you got a sin that dwelleth in me doctrine, you're going to give authority to things in your life that are purely demonic. You better have, it's Christ that dwelleth in me. You better come to understand how that your faith becomes effective. It begins to work. It becomes powerful when you acknowledge every good thing that is in you in Christ Jesus. You know, I should just be giving you the scriptures as I speak them. You know, I, of course, you know, I refer to here, I just referred to Romans 10, 6 and Romans 10, 10. And I just referred to Philemon 1, 6, 1, 7. This is really, this is the battlefield. Really, this is the issue where we go run off, where we go native on God. Here we are full of the Holy Ghost and in the meeting, and then on about midday Monday, we done gone native. We done run off doing our own thing, thinking, gotten all upset about something, emotionally squealing out, peeling out, I mean, squealing out too. Getting all wrapped up in some situation because the press is on and we just gave authority to something over our life that is dictating to us a behavior, a response, an action, an attitude, and then a whole bunch of words start flowing out of our mouth. Dear people, God's called us into a place of relying on Him. God wants us to be, we don't want to be preacher-made people. We don't want to be self-made people. We want to be God-made people. We want to come to recognize we have begun in the Holy Ghost by this wonderful miracle salvation. And we're also perfected by the Holy Ghost through the same miracle, wonderful growth that comes by Him, knowing that every day in Christ Jesus we're getting stronger and stronger. We're being made, we're renewed day by day, that our outward man perish. 2 Corinthians 4:16. Our inward man is renewed day by day. We just come to understand a maturation process, a going from glory to glory, a going from strength to strength, that all finds its context within our acknowledging, our looking at, our viewing those things which God has declared concerning us. People, all these witnesses are going to come around us, and they're going to say that you're something else. You're insignificant. You don't matter. That's not true. You're just the same old you with the same old problems and whatever else. And demons are going to get involved in it and accuse you and slander you and make you feel like you can't lift your head up and look, you know, look beyond the floor. You can't lift your head up to see any good thing that's about to come. And you have to be willing and obedient to God. And begin to shout out His word. There was a time in my life that I shouted out. You know, maybe people who was listening, they only heard one side of the conversation and might have thought I was a little bit out of my mind. My thing was, I wanted to get out of my mind quickly. Amen. I wanted to get into His mind.
Yes.
Amen. Huh? Amen. I just shouted, "You leave me alone. That's a lie in the name of Jesus. That's not true. Father, I just thank You for Your word. I thank You for the promises. I thank You for the things that You've forever settled in heaven concerning this wonderful relationship that I have with You. I thank You, Father, You perfect everything that concerns me. I'm Yours. You're mine. I'm in You. You're in me. I'm with You. You're with me. I'm the apple of Your eye. I'm Your favorite. And there's room, everybody, God's got room for everybody to be His favorite. So that's grace, Your favorite. God made You favorite. That means you can receive grace from God. Amen. He's empowered you. He's given you everything that pertains to life and godliness. That is, He didn't leave anybody out. The grace of God has appeared to all men, not some men. He's empowered us. We have to be willing to come under the authority of His word. If we do not come under the authority of His word and live under the authority of His word, you will by default live under the authority of something else. Men are devils. Huh? The Lord says, cursed is the man who trusts in men. I mean, how much strong language. Cursed is the man who trusts in the arm of flesh. You know, I'll let the Lord sort that out. I let the Lord show me. Father, am I trusting in my own human ability? Because I know that is an offense to You. I know You're not going to be able to work the way You want to work in my life if I'm not relying on the Holy Ghost. So I just went ahead and advanced it, and I just said, okay, anything I have need of, I ask the Holy Spirit to give it to me. Holy Spirit, I need love. Would You please give me some love? Sometimes I come to church, and I feel like, Lord, I need some love. I'm not kidding you. Huh? Sometimes I go to, it's every situation, you know, it's just like you can get overwhelmed with circumstance. Get overwhelmed with situation. Are the people going to be happy tonight, or are they just going to sit there? And you got to holler at them about, are you going to worship God now? And people, why? Because you see people under the yoke, people under the influence, under the authority of other things in their life. Well, why then would I, you know, I'm all concerned about people being under the authority of other things. Now I'm going to come under the authority of it too. Because that's the way it works. It just spreads like a virus, spreads like a flu. And I just say, okay, I just stop right there. I stop right there. I say, Holy Ghost, fill me with your love. Amen. We're God-made people.
Yes.
We see the Lord empowered us. He said to you and me, by empowering us, he said, be strong in the strength of the Lord and power of his might. Now think about it. If God was depending upon you and me to get that, then God said, I set for you now to get the same, to be as strong as I am and as be as powerful as I am. Now you get with the program right now. Well, we're stuck. We can't do nothing. What do you mean? Where am I supposed to get that from? How am I supposed to be that? You're God, I'm nobody. He empowers us. He gives us empowering words. He didn't say, you do it. He empowers us. He gives us the right. He says, be. And we are. Just like he says, light be and light was. He does the same thing with us. We have to be willing to receive it. We got to be willing to believe it. We've got to be willing to be responsive to him. We've got to hear him say it, and it's good news. It was good news to blind Bartimaeus when they said, the master is calling you. Woo-hoo! He laid aside. The scripture says he threw aside his beggar's garment. And I don't know how he read, but I would imagine, you know, you see blind people. You ever seen a blind person run? They run with a great security. It's like side-to-side kind of thing. You with me? I don't know where they're going to go with these steps, but they can't stride this way. They kind of stride side to side. There he takes off. Hallelujah. He was empowered. There's an event, about a miraculous event about to take place for me. There's an expectation. Faith is built on expectation. It's built on confidence that is supplied. Even the expectation and confidence is supplied to us by the Holy Ghost. Those are fruits of the Spirit. Those are the activities of the Holy Ghost in our life. Why? Because we make God's word the absolute truth, the authority, the reality of our life. Everything else is invalidated.
Amen.
That's hard. That's a battle. And you're going to have to practice that. And perfect practice makes perfect. Hallelujah. Somebody said, how do I get strong? All you've got to do is participate. All you've got to do is talk with the Holy Ghost on a daily basis. All you've got to do is continue to look to him. All you've got to do is ask him. All you got to do is say, Lord Jesus. All you got to do is say, Father, deliver me from, keep me from temptation. Lead me not into temptation and keep me from the evil. I mean, can you, I don't even imagine, how can you go a day without saying that? When you know that he's the one who can do it, and he said that's what his job is, and but we think, well, we're just going to happen passively. We're not going to say nothing. We got a gag order when it comes to declaring the word, but we got a big mouth when it comes to declaring everything else. When it comes to praise, we're hardly saying anything, but when it comes to curses and problems and murmur and complaining, our mouth's wide open, and it's filled with a long list of speech. This guy get turned around. That's not an evidence that you've not been born again. That's an evidence of stupid. That's an evidence of you aren't quickened. You're not doing what you're supposed to be doing. You're not participating with the Holy Ghost. You're not relying upon the one who worked a miracle for you. And every day is supposed to be a miracle. God will work a miracle for you.
Amen.
Every day is a miracle.
Yes, it is.
We're going to wake up in the morning, on Monday morning, and you know what Monday is for us? Monday is Miracle Monday for us. Every second is sacred. There's no unsacred seconds. Every minute belongs to God. Every hour is an opportunity to know him more. One step closer to that place where we stand before him and give an account for the deeds done in a body. Every day has value. Every day has meaning. We place it on it. We place that value and that meaning on every day, in every part of our life, because these are the things that God has said. And we take our place in him, and we allow Jesus to be the head over everything of our life. We hold the head in its proper position. And holding the head, look at my whole body's holding my head. My hand's not going, pay attention to me. I mean, my whole body's serving my head. My whole body, my toes are not even feeling left out at all right now. That my head's getting all the attention. In fact, it's fine to cover up the entirety of my body. And no one's complaining here. Holding Jesus in his proper place, where all that we see is Jesus and all that we're doing is for Jesus and all the servitude is about Jesus, about the life. He's given us his life, and it's at the expense of us losing our own life. If you lose your life, you'll find your life.
That's right.
And that happened as a miracle where we said, I no longer live, it's Christ who lives. That's the definition of being born again. And people draw back from it. They're afraid to say it because of self-evaluation. Their evaluation now of their self has been given authority to speak into their lives. And your blemishes now have authorities over your life and weaknesses and frailties. God said, I'll take care of them. I'll be on the inside of you. I'll pray. I'll intercede with groanings which cannot be uttered. I'll uphold you. I'll secure you. I'll keep you by my own power. I'm kept by keep through thine own name them that you have given unto me, that none of them shall be lost on that day. This is the word of God. This is the life of God. This is the security of the believer. These are the things that we got to allow to reign and rule our hearts and our mind. This is where we let the word of Christ dwell in us richly. People have become so overwhelmed with their daily cares of this life, they have little time to spend with the word. You spend time with the word, God the Holy Ghost is going to bring it into your remembrance. You're going to remember God's word. The memory of God is going to quicken you. Hallelujah. You give no place to the word really in your life? You don't meditate on the word, there's no way you can be prosperous. You let this word of this covenant depart out of your mouth, there's no way that you're going to be successful. Because reality, by default, you're going to be overwhelmed by there's so many voices. They're screaming. They're demanding of you. They're slapping you around. They're forceful. Come on now. But give yourself over to the word of God. I'm going, you know, Papa, he's amazing. If you give him one verse of scripture in the morning, he'll take that and rule over you with it. He's amazing. He'd say, I'm not telling you, not even going to get me to participate unless you at least spend 30 minutes. He doesn't do that. He takes whatever little we're willing to do in participation with them, and he multiplies it, and he brings to pass something, good work on the inside of our lives. And then all of a sudden, we should have wake up and say, wow, one verse of scripture just took me through the day. What would happen if I did like 10?
Amen.
Is it going to be 10 times? No, it's not linear. It's not linear relationship. It'd be far more than 10 times. It'd be far more than 10 times. I'm willing to go with an exponential relationship of some sort. Hallelujah. Father's just waiting for us to catch on. He's just waiting for us to believe the good report, to believe the good news. Good news. Good news. I'm on the inside of you. Good news. The Spirit of your Father dwells in you. Good news. It's the Holy Ghost going to talk through you. Good news. You're the temple of the living God. Good news. You're blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Good news. I provide for you according to my riches and glory. Good news. I'm with you always, even unto the end of the world. Good news. I'll live in you, walk in you. I'll be your God. You'll be my people. I got a God that can prove himself to be God. He is God. And he proves himself over and again to be God. But I've got to come under his authority. I've got to be willing to live under his authority. I've got to be willing to say, okay, Father, what would you have me to do now? Father, what's the right answer here? I don't have to sit there and wait. Here you're standing at work, you know, at your desk. And you said, Lord, what's the right answer? And the boss comes by, you're just staring, you're doing nothing. And he says, well, what's going on? We're supposed to be getting some productivity. I'm waiting for God to answer. That ain't gonna work. And you don't do it that way. Father, you speak to him. You say, Father, show me what I'm supposed to do here. Give me direction. And you go on with your business. And you keep, and he'll keep that which you commit to him, and he'll work it out so that you can hear, and he'll work it out. He'll put the answer right in front of your face, and it'll be neon flashing lights. This is the answer. You won't see it for a while, even then he'll start blowing the horn. And the horn's going up, you know, and flashing lights, and then you probably still don't get it. So he'll cause it to stand out and come in and out on you, and finally, oh, there's the answer. Yeah, I've been trying to get your attention. But then after a while, we get used to having him answer, and now it's just going to take a horn and blinking lights. And then it becomes just blinking lights, and then we see it. We're able to, then it goes, we don't need flashing lights, bells, whistles, horns, blasts, lightnings. It's the answer. Oh, a relationship with God. It is wonderful to come into a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. I tell you, it has dialogue going on. It is continual dialogue that is going on, and is the closest that you get to praying without ceasing. It is a conversation with God. It's a dialogue. It's saying, Holy Spirit, I have need of love right now because these people are aggravating me. Or you just choose to get aggravated. Lord, I have need of peace right now because I'm being condemned. I'm feeling worthless. I'm feeling useless. Give me peace, because peace commands the darkness and condemnation to go. Lord, you see, I'm being overwhelmed. I'm having to take the MCAT, and I just got my grades back or whatever, and sorrow is filling my heart. And I need joy right now. Why? Because this is now looking at the grades. What am I looking at? I'm looking at the way that I view myself. This is the value of who I am. I got an A. I got a C. It shouldn't be meaningful at all. It shouldn't even touch you. You just say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. It's in your hands. Thank you for, if you got a C, thank you, Father, for teaching me humility. Strengthen me, Lord, to get it better. And he's probably going to say, quit being so lazy and start studying more. It's probably going to be the answer. He's not going to give you a brain transplant. He's going to say, quit being so lazy. I was like, it's like the preacher is on the platform, and he's waiting. The music's going on. They're still singing. He don't know what he's going to preach on yet. He's like, oh, God, oh, God, oh, God, give me word, give me word, give me word. Oh, Lord, give me word, give me word. Oh, God, give me word. And he hears, quit being so lazy. That was the word from heaven. He needed to spend some time in the Word before he got to the platform. Yeah, hallelujah. There's a participation that goes on, a fellowship with God, where we're interacting with Him, where we dialogue with Him, where we're depending upon Him for everything. We understand that curses the person that trusts in the arm of flesh. We're not going to trust in the arm of flesh. We're not going to look to other things to provide what we have need of. We're going to start disciplining ourselves to just trust God. And I know it's scary. I know it's scary. Scare you to death. It's a fearful thing. It's a ferocious thing to be engaged in. I mean, you got to become fearless. How many of you start stepping out to trust God and quit trusting yourself? Father, I know that you're going to take care of this. I know that you're going to provide. Where you begin to become overwhelmed with this love so that the fear can go away. Fear is a formidable foe. Fear is the biggest thing that every one of us have to deal with, and it comes at us from so many different directions. And Father wants us to understand how to receive a love supply that comes from the Holy Ghost that just shuts all of that down. And you know that God rules in the kingdom of men. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know that He's with you, that He's going to protect you, that He surrounds you, that He's going to uphold you. Hallelujah. That you're kept by the power of God through faith and salvation, ready to be revealed in the last day. Wherein we rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, having received the end of our faith. Even though if needed, right now, you're in heaven, it's through many trials and tribulation, that the trying of your faith, which is much more precious than gold, might be found unto glory and honor at the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And a lot of people find themselves in a lot of tribulation. Huh? Because why? If needed. See the if needed clause there? You know where I'm, how many of you know the verse of scripture I'm referring to? Because you sit there and studied it and misapplied it to your life. Yes, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 5. That is correct. Hallelujah. It's not fair she lives with me. First Peter, not second. That is a well-marked up Bible there. This is spectacular. Every verse of scripture has a color code on it. That's great. See that? We are kept. Who are kept? That's we. We are kept by the power of God. See that? See, I'm kept. What shall I have? Who should I fear? What should I be afraid? Why should I be concerned? For the arrow flies by night, for the pestilence that wastes at noonday. Huh? Why should I be concerned about the terrible, monstrous bills? Huh? The threatening power of the almighty dollar. When I have the almighty God keeping me. Jesus said, keep through thine own name, Father, those that you have given to me, that none of them should be lost. I'm kept by the power of God. Keep through thine own name, Father. Jesus saying, Father, keep through thy own name. Why should I ever fear again? All I have to do is just sit on the stairs, come under the authority of his word and say to myself, I'm kept by the power of God. What do I have? Why? So why do you fear? Oh, probo si kiri bina satira. Meleng diribiko siya na negikia kadea na na. It's hard to preach on these things because I think too much about them, you know, and I just get carried away with the goodness of God. And I just, look at that. Ready. I'm hoping to be ready. Ready. I'm ready. I'm good. For my garments are spotless. They are whiter than snow. I've been washed. I'm ready. Are you ready? I'm ready. Are you ready? I think so. You're giving something in your life, around your life, authority that it should not have. Doubt and unbelief got a hold of you. It's exalting itself above the knowledge of Jesus Christ. It's exalting itself above the Word of God. I want you to get this. I want you to get it. I want you to grab a hold of these things. I want you to quit being so self-confident and so self-assured and start having God confidence and Amen. God assurance, yes. Divine assurance. Yes. Divine assurance is far greater than self-assurance. Amen. The self-assurance is going to be wavering. It's going to be up one day, down the next. Oh, but God, divine assurance. Ooh, Rabba Sikiti Lamosate. Look at that. Look. Look at this. Ready to be revealed. I have an inheritance in Jesus Christ that is undefiled. Ooh, I have a treasure in this earthen vessel that is above reproach. It's unblameable. It's unrebukable. Think about that. It's holy and it's everything that is acceptable unto God. Think about that. It's got a reservation. Hallelujah. They gave me the Billy Graham scholarship to go do a doctorate degree at a particular seminary, and they asked me this silly question. When you stand at the gate of heaven, what reasons are you going to give that you should be able to enter in? Something to that effect. I said, that is ridiculous. First of all, it ain't going down like that. And I thought you guys were one of the prestigious seminaries in the United States of America, and you're giving me this hypothetical that has absolutely no meaning or value at all biblically. I wasn't accepted.
Praise God.
I think I was accepted. They were just going to charge me more money. I think that's what happened in the end. Something like that. Actually. Why should the Lord stand there? I think they actually said St. Peter standing there asking you why he should let you in the gate, why God should let you into the kingdom. And I know what they wanted me to answer this silly question. Listen, it ain't right. It isn't even right. I want what God says. This is what he's done. These are the things that he's done for me. This new creation. Hallelujah. Old things have passed away. Everything is new. Everything about me belongs to God. All things belong to God, not part of me. He's created me again, renewed me again in his image after righteousness and true holiness. There's no horns in that. There's no scales or bifurcated tail. I think some people can't hear me. They're just sitting back there going. They're thinking about that thing that should not have authority in their lives. They're thinking about that prison that has been opened up. The door's wide open. Walk out, man. Enjoy yourself. There's enough joy here. There's enough goodness. There's enough gladness. There's enough faith so that you can have everything that God has purposed for you to have. Nothing that God has said is yours will be yours until you believe it so. Until faith moves within your framework of your life and you lay hold of that which He has freely given. And then you can freely give it. You pay for it, you're going to make everybody else pay for it too. Oh, he's hollering now. That's fine. If you're nervous, we'll get you fixed. Amen. I had words to say to me, we would come to the meeting, but my dad hollered at me when I was young, and it just scares me to death when you start hollering. I said, we can fix that. I would bring my friends, but we've all been abused. What brings this abuse into memories? You start hollering, but it's a good holler.
Right.
It's a Holy Ghost shout. No, listen, I've been pastoring for 33 years. I've pastored hundreds and hundreds of people. And it's a proof. Somebody said, are you sure you're called to be a pastor? That's the funniest thing. Are you sure you're called to be a pastor? Well, you know what? If you spent 1 year being a pastor, you'd be absolutely certain that I've been called to be a pastor. Try it. See if you can make it through 1 year pastoring. It's an inside joke, I know. Hallelujah. You only know the stuff that I have in my interaction with you personally. That's all you know about. And by the way, how is that? Has that been good? I mean, how often have you thought upon me in a good light?
Often.
And then how often have you thought upon me in a... Okay. Here, let me have the skinny.
Sure.
No, I want you to read it. Verse, wherein we greatly rejoice. If you've got that first part in verse 5, if you begin to just reckon with the reality that you kept by His power, that you kept through His own name, that His name is jealous. What's His name? Jealous. God's name is jealous. He's jealous. Who's He jealous over? Me. And He's jealously protecting and jealously keeping us. You're going to get real happy and verse 6 is going to kick in. We're in the fact that we are kept by His power through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last day, wherein we greatly rejoice are you reading this? See, this is all. You know what this is supposed to be? This isn't supposed to be a commandment. This is supposed to be a discovery. This is why I'm so happy. This is why I'm walking around singing and rejoicing and just overwhelmed with such gladness. It's okay. I'm okay. I thought that there was something terribly wrong with me because it didn't seem like I fit in any churches. Everybody seems so sad. They're all got the cross up there. Jesus is on it. And they're all singing, there's room at the cross for me. There we go. Wherein you greatly rejoice, though now for a season. Though now for a season. Though now for a season, if need be. I'm interested in not needed. How many would you like to be not needed? How many of you would like the most or bigger part of verse 6 not to apply? And the bigger part of verse 7 not to reply, apply? And just go ahead, jump right to 8. Whom having received the completion or the end or the fulfillment of your salvation and rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. Huh? Why not that? Why not? Let's just do that. Why don't let's just be done with allowing or giving place to wrong authorities in our life? Why don't we just be done with all of that stuff, come under the rule and the reign of the Word of God, under the rule and the reign of the sovereign majesty of the sovereign living God, Christ Jesus, who's head over all principalities and powers of might and dominion, and know that nothing can touch you. Amen. Nothing can touch you. The Holy Ghost will make you so amazingly bold. I was in a meeting in China, in Nanyang, China. It's actually where Brother Yun is from. It's the most hostile place in China against Christian movement, in Henan province. And everybody that was in the meeting, the building was packed out. Everybody that was in the meeting were all preachers. They were all leaders of the House Church of China, Underground Church of China, and represented millions and millions of people. And most of them, well, all of them, had been in prison at one time or other. I think the only person that might not have been in prison was my translator and the person who came and picked me up at the airport and took me from Beijing to Nanyang. Everybody else had been in prison many years. On the front row, on this side, there was a whole row of women. They were all battered and beaten, swollen eyes. It was their last police beating. And every one of them, just about every one of them that was there, they would go to prison for the rest of their life if the military police, Secret Service police of China showed up, because the People's Republic of China look at this as a threat to their national security, and they don't take it any more lightly than we would take a threat to our national security. And there was just such boldness there. There was just for us this fearless men and women of God. And some military guys showed up. And as soon as they showed up, such an incredible Holy Ghost boldness grabbed a hold of me. And I began to minister, a shift the meeting right there to Ephesians chapter 1, verse 23 and verse 24. And I began to declare how that Christ Jesus was head over all governments, including the People's Republic of China. How that he was head over all principalities and powers of might and dominion. And his church was the fullness of him that fills all things. So his church is actually the one in charge of the People's Republic of China. Nobody got arrested. The secret police and the military police pursued me for several hundred miles. I was always a stop ahead of them. Praise God. I mean, at the end analysis, we hit, you know, the church is so well organized, they were able to say, yeah, you had just left on the train. They were all through the train station looking everywhere for you. We got to Liyang. They said that there was a possibility. One of the guys that was with me received a telephone call, said, we think the secret police are going to be waiting for you at Liyang. And we got there. And the way things happened, our transition, the way we went from one train to the next train, we were gone, and they received information. They were all to the train station, looking on the trains, looking for us. We're protected, you see. Because we're just speaking the word of God. We're not under the threats of men. I must say I was afraid when I got on the train, and they told me they're going to be waiting for us, get rid of everything. And, you know, I did. My knees smote together, because those prisons are terrible. It's a threatening thing. It's a terrible thing. But Father gives us great Holy Ghost boldness. You know, and what did I do? I just begin to comfort myself in the Lord. I just begin to thank Him. I begin to say, Father, first of all, You'd have to do with my life whatever you want to do in my life. Wherever you want me to go, I'll go. Wherever you want me to be, I'll be. But Lord, I thank you for your protection. Lord, you know I promised Joshua that I was going to be home for his high school graduation. And he's going to graduate next week. And I'm not going to be able to be there, obviously, if I'm in prison. And Father, you know, I don't like their food. I just went down the list. Put in my order. It's wonderful when you begin to find a relationship with the Lord where sin comes to try to claim you, try to take authority over you. Say, Lord, I don't want this sin. You see how it's pulling on me. You see this temptation pulling on me. Lord, I want you to rebuke Satan. I want you to come protect me. I look to you, Father. I only want your ways. I want you to come rule over me. Holy Spirit, come fill me right now with the authority that hates evil and loves righteousness. I want to be able to feel the way you feel, Father, about this situation that is impinging upon my spirit and my soul right now. A dialogue, a relationship where we become dependent upon the Holy Spirit, knowing that we've not begun in the Spirit to now be made perfect through our own human discipline or human efforts and human ability. But having begun by the miracle of the Holy Spirit, we are perfected by the miracle working of the Holy Spirit. And all we've got to do is give Him place in our life. And we give Him place in our life by just asking Him, by recognizing that it's there. He wants us to say, Lord, lead me not into temptation, but deliver me from evil, because yours is the power. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the power and the glory, both now and forever. And there's a place in God, dear people, with our volition where we say, I don't want sin and iniquity. I don't want sickness and disease. I don't want sadness and sorrow. I don't want poverty and oppression. I don't want the dictates of the atmosphere of this world, the spirit of disobedience, the condemnation, the accusation, the guilt, the shame, the sorrow. I don't want any of these things, the fear, to have any place of rulership or influence over my life. I want to find myself baptized in the very presence of a holy God, in the place called the Holies of Holies, baptized in the glory of the Holy Spirit, not just filled, baptized, sink to the bottom and breathe. Kind of. Whew, living. And then you don't make it into something that's going to be in the future. You read the Word and discover it is now, and you embrace it as now. And then you stand in it and you think, and you stand in it and you thank Him and you rejoice in Him in it. The only reason that there needs to be heaviness is because you're being disobedient or stubborn, and you won't listen, and you won't hearken unto the voice of God. Look at that. God did it over and again in the Old Testament. They wouldn't hearken. They wouldn't listen. He just allowed the things that they were giving place to in their life to overwhelm them, to bring them to a place of submission to His Word. He led them through the wilderness. He took them a hard way. He took them the hard way. He took them the hard way. Led them through the wilderness so that they could learn that man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. And there's Jesus in the midst of a temptation. In the midst of Satan's full-fledged attack against him, says, if you be the Son of God, turn the stone into bread. He said, man shall not live by bread alone. I'm not interested in the bread. You can't tip me with the bread. I'm only interested in the Word. Hallelujah. You've overcome the wicked one, young men. You've overcome the wicked one because the Word of God abides in you. Robasete yoto shepekila anasutirati. Hallelujah. 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 Spiritual development comes strong when you covet spiritual development. Spiritual development actually it's the force of God's will upon your life. And you don't think that's going to happen quickly? If that's what you're saying, if you covet the spiritual, as according to 1 Corinthians chapter 14, it absolutely is happening. People then in doubt, well, they can't measure it. They analyze it themselves. they coming under the examination, the critical evaluation of their own, you know, personal perception of things. Don't do that. You can't see very far. You can't see very far. You can't see very well anyways. Even if you, even in the distance that you see, you're going to have to see through the eyes of the Word of God. You're going to have to call it so. You're going to have to quit letting Satan accuse you and making you insignificant. You're going to have to quit letting the situation and the circumstances make you insignificant. You're going to have to rise up in the identity of God. You're going to have to quit needing someone to constantly reassure you that you're okay. It's a form of insanity. Am I okay? Yeah, you're okay. Am I okay now? Yeah, you're still okay. How about now? Yeah, you're still okay. You're just as okay as you were a second ago. How am I doing now? You're doing good. You're fine. Are you sure? Yes, I am. Am I going to be all right? Yeah, you are. Father wants to root us and ground us in. What does he want to root us and ground us in?
Love.
He wants to root us and ground us and settle us in love. Whose love? God's love for us. God's devoted love for us. God's devoted love, my goodness gracious, has been revealed to us on a scale that defies all possible imagination and reasoning. That Father God would do such a work as to take the Word from His bosom and allow the Word, and the Word would be willing to become flesh, and He who is rich become poor for our sake, to be spit upon, to be mocked, to be ridiculed, to be rejected, to subject Himself to temptation when God cannot be tempted. To have to suffer the affliction of even being tempted, to be subjected to everything that we subjected to be just so that He could be the perfect sacrifice for you and me, to be offered upon an altar, so that you and I could have everything that He possesses. To believe this, to grab a hold of it, to be so thankful to God for the wonderful things that He has done for us. To be able to sing throughout the day, redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. To begin to rejoice in God, your Savior, because you're kept by His power. Because He's providing for you everything that you have need of. That He's not only your provider, and He's not only your protector, but He's also your perfecter. He leads me. The Holy Ghost is here to lead me. You don't wake up in the morning and say, the Holy Ghost doesn't like me. I'm sure He doesn't like me. I had a bad dream. And all the other things that people allow to work in their mind and in their thinking. And even if you were to do something terribly evil, something terribly wrong, yet He stands there with arms extended saying, come unto me. Come be washed. Come be cleansed. Come be forgiven. He doesn't stand there with a stick of condemnation. He stands there, I have a gift for you, I have a love, my blood is sufficient, I'm able to cleanse you, I'm able to wash you, I'll take care of you, just come here. Somebody said, will the Lord give me another chance? He'll give you as many chances as you need, so long as your heart is real towards Him. People that are condemning of you and accusatory, that's demonic. That's the realms of the demonic. Don't listen to it. I don't care if it comes in your thoughts or through somebody else's mouth. Yeah, do you keep your heart with all diligence? You don't let that trash touch you. It's right out of hell. And come under the power of it. Just deal with the foul spirit for what it is. It's foul. Holy Ghost doesn't have one accusing word, no one condemning word. Not one judgmental word. It's all coming to me. I love you. I'll wash you. Let me strengthen you. Let me help you. Let me perfect you. Let me lead you. Let me guide you. One day there will come a day. There will come a day of judgment. And all judgment is left unto that day. Until that day, no one can lay any charge against God's elect. You may not understand what it is they're saying, what it is they're doing. Father says, you just leave that to me. You just leave it to me. You love, you bless, you support. You come under the authority of the Holy Ghost. You don't want to let depression have authority over your life. You don't want to let sorrow have authority over your life. You don't want bad attitudes to have authority over your life. You don't want unforgiveness to have authority over your life. You don't want something happening yesterday have authority over your life. You don't want offense to have authority over your life. You don't want hate to have authority over your life. You don't want bitterness to have authority over your life. You don't want nothing to have over authority over your life. You want to be washed away. You want to be liberated so that all that has influence and authority over your life is the good things of heaven. God bought you with the price. You're His. You're not your own. You belong to Him. Isn't that good? You don't have to ever feel bad one day about belonging to Him. The miracle of salvation. I want to read just real quickly something to you here in Romans. I mean, like there's times where I'm ministering and I just stop and say, Lord, forgive me for that attitude. Does that happen to you in the meetings? Don't get there and sit there and beat yourself up about, oh, I'm just a miserable wretch. I'm the worst child in God's whole kingdom. No, His word's liberating. It's empowering. It quickens us. It brings light. We just immediately, when we're convicted, we respond. God convicts us so that we can get right.
Yes, thank you.
He doesn't convict us so that we'll be wrong. Hallelujah. Amen. He convicts us so to basarekadeh, yeshula borotai. So that we can be right. Just be sensitive to Him. You want your heart to be tender. Annalyn said, come into the other meeting and said, I want my heart to be tender. Brittany came up and said, I want my heart to be sensitive. And, dear me, look, that's easy. Just stay with Him. Just stay with Him. Don't allow other things in your life. And your heart gets so tender, your heart gets so sensitive that anything that's going on wrong around you, it feels like somebody stabs you in the chest with a knife. Anything that you would do is even worse than that. And you immediately go right to the throne of grace and say, oh, God, forgive me. I don't want this pain in my chest. This hurts. Because it's actually the Lord allowing us to feel a physical pain that's actually spiritual. He's trying to emphasize to us. He gives us the ability to see the Holy Ghost to come hook up with us and lead us and guide us. He'll show us. He'll make these things real to us and meaningful to us. It'll be a living experience. As it is a living relationship. We'll come to discover that every good thing that pertains to life and godliness is found in Him. That's all the only place we want to be. In His presence is peace, and outside of His presence there is no peace. In His presence there's fullness of joy. Outside of His presence there's only sorrow and sadness. And Christ Jesus is the door, and we can come on in by the blood of the Lamb at any time. And hopefully you come on in and stay there. And if you find yourself out, get back in quickly and don't leave again. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that You're teaching us Your ways. See, there's a new birth, and then there's a maturing. There's a growing every day. Religion will never let you come to the fullness and the maturity of the ministry of Jesus. At best, people will try to say they'll give you a lifetime to come into the fullness and the measure of the maturity of the ministry of Jesus. But really, religion won't ever allow you to come into the fullness of the measure of the maturity of the ministry of Jesus in a lifetime. But the Lord has it available for you right now. And really, it comes down to how much we're going to surrender, how much we're willing to participate, how we're willing to walk in perfect obedience, how we're willing, in other words, when I say walk in perfect obedience, I'm talking about fully relying upon the Holy Spirit, living in Him, not moving outside of Him. Huh? Keeping yourself in the love of God. Hallelujah. You know how to do that? You know how to keep yourself in the love of God? You know how to build yourself up in your most holy faith and keep yourself in the love of God? You know what your holy faith can do? Can move mountains.
Amen.
You know what your holy faith can do? It makes it where nothing's impossible for you. Shouldn't you want to build yourself up in your most holy faith?
Amen.
You know you can't be in your most holy faith nor build yourself up in the most holy faith unless you keep yourself in the love of God. Did you know that? Did you understand that we speak the truth in love, or we live this wonderful life of love in Christ Jesus? And that there we begin to discover every dimension of the fullness of God. I want you to just look at that verse of scripture real quickly, Ephesians 4:15. I just want you to look at it real quickly before I take you just over into this other passage of scripture. Just a couple of things I want to show you. Look at that quickly, Ephesians 4:15. We look at here and we see in 4:15, but speaking the truth in love, living out the truth in love, you may grow up in Him in all things. Just understand this. Just hear this one part of the pericope. You may grow up into him in all things or in every dimension. Of his fullness have all we received, and you may grow up into him. You were born again so that you may grow up. You were set apart and sanctified so that you may grow up. It's not a process of redemption. Neither is it a process of sanctification. Neither is it a process of righteousness. Neither is it a process of holiness. It's been gifted to us. It's been given to us by the miraculous grace of God's divine favor so that we may now grow up into these things. We may be renewed day by day. We may look into with unveiled faces, look into the mirror and behold the glory of God and be changed from glory to glory. His goodness, so that we can increase with the increase of God, so that we can go from strength to strength, so that we may comprehend with all saints what is the height, the depth, the breadth, the length, to know the love of God which passes knowledge, and be filled there with all the fullness of God. A living place, a real place, that all you and I have to do is with a simple, childlike obedience to God, participate with what he's doing, enter into a dialogue, a relationship, make Christ Jesus a part of every dimension of your life, depend upon the Holy Spirit for everything that you need in terms of love and joy and the riches that come and the spiritual blessings that he's provided for us, and even also the things that you have need of physically as well. He'll do those things for you, and financially, materially. But you're going to have to understand it. It will not be a reality so long as you give other things dominion over your life. So long as you give other influences authority over your life, it will stop you. It will shut it down. It will contaminate things. I'm going to tell you, God became so enraged against the murmuring and complaining. He said, though my work was finished from the foundation of the world, I swear in my wrath, you will not enter into my rest. Though I elected it and foreordained it and finished it. And I'm just putting it in other words. You're not coming in. People are constantly in the complaint, constantly allowing wrong attitudes, wrong ways of thinking, wrong influence, wrong people speaking into the life, wrong ideas influencing their processes of thinking. You never come in. You won't come in. You want to build yourself up in your most holy faith. How are you going to do that? Keep self in the love of God. How are you going to do that? Praying in the Holy Ghost. Somebody said, why are you praying in the Holy Ghost all the time? Because I need to be keeping myself in the love of God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. There's a love that he supplies that is not innately, it is not innately given to me when I was born of my father and my mother. There is a love that only he supplies. Now that I am a new creation, it only comes from him. Listen, when we were born again, we've given a new heart, new spirit. God didn't take away the knowledge of good and evil, and the knowledge of good and evil was too much for men. It was too much for Adam, and it's too much for us. It was too much for Adam in a pure and innocent state, and it's too much for you and me now in our state, in the new birth. And thus we must totally, 100% depend upon God and God alone, for he alone knows how to deal with the knowledge of good and evil. He alone knows how to teach us how to have the same resolve that he has, same choices that he makes, the same wisdom and insight that he possesses. This walk is a miracle walk. It demands our 100% dependence upon the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of holiness, God the Holy Ghost, the life-giving power, the living God, who's so dedicated to our success. He's come and he has humbled himself to take up his dwelling place and his abode on the inside of our lives, making our very own body his temple. Somebody said this old filthy rag. God calls it his temple. God calls it his temple. God calls it sacred.
Yes.
My hands are sacred, my feet are sacred, my mouth is sacred. Somebody said, the tongue is a world of iniquity set on fire of hell. Not mine. Mine's a world of blessing set on fire, the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. So long as the word of God's coming out of my mouth, people have got the negative side of things. They've given place to the things of darkness, and they've given wrong place to the wrong authorities in their life. It's time we begin to believe the good word of God, the good testimony that Christ Jesus has given concerning us, the things that the Holy Spirit's doing in us. No, I don't believe in nothing else. I don't believe anything else. I'm not believing anything else. There's only one source of truth. Can you find truth among men?
No.
God's word alone is truth. You can find facts among men, but those are subjective and continually changing. Most of what they call facts is anecdotal evidence. Looks like it, but it wasn't really. It seemed to be, but there was no established proofs. And then they build their whole world of inference and opinion around that, and then you believe it, gullible, and allow it to have authority over your life, insane. Now I'm going to top this off here now. I'm going to top the tank off here. So you guys are going to be ready to go. And it's good that we have church here almost every night. It's good. And some of you take advantage of the fact that we have church here almost every night. Praise the Lord. Well, right now we're having church here every night, aren't we? Because Monday night's the special meetings now that are going on. Tuesday night, some more special meetings. Wednesday night's a special meeting. Then Thursday night, we have a special meeting. Friday night, there's another special meeting. Amen. And then this Saturday, there's a very, very special meeting. And then Sunday, once again, morning and night, we have a special meeting. And you can get as much. Why have all of this room and not do anything with it? Somebody said, oh, well, you're just sitting around there in the place. You should be doing something. We are doing something. We're interacting with the living God, being filled up, being empowered by Him, because He'll cause us to rise up and do things in Him in one day that we could have never accomplished in a lifetime, though we had lived 10 lifetimes or 1,000 lifetimes, or though we had lived 1,000,000 years. Let me open your Bibles really quickly to Romans chapter 6. Tonight I thought I was going to come in here and I give you an overview of Romans chapter 6 and Romans chapter 7 and Romans chapter 8. I love to teach on that. I think I spent about 10 years of my life ministering on Romans chapter 6, 7, and 8. Because when I was young, the Lord would come to me in a dream and hold up a scroll in front of me with a language that I couldn't read. Just imagine trying to get some sleep, trying to read a scroll all night. Staring at the thing. It got to be pretty interesting because I knew what I was going to dream when I went to bed. I went to bed and I went to sleep and it wouldn't be long. And here come the scroll. And there it was, a language that I could not read. And then one day it turned into a language that I could read. It was Romans chapter 6, Romans chapter 7, Romans chapter 8. And the Lord filled me with His understanding. And so it was such a shock to me. It was so overwhelming to me. I just spent a lot of my life just ministering, teaching on Romans chapter 6, Romans chapter 7, Romans chapter 8. But I do want to, before you go here tonight, I want to point out something in Romans chapter 6, because I don't want you to let sin have dominion over you. I don't want you to let all this stuff have dominion over you. It has no right. Sin does not dwell in you. Christ Jesus does. He's not bunking with the devil either. Devil, you can have top bunk tonight. I'll take the bottom bunk. Huh? Would you go and live in an apartment complex with a bunch of devils? You're going to tell me God moved the holies of holies into a realm of the demonic? It's nuts. He moved the holies of holies into your heart. He's a good God. All that is in the world, not all that's in my heart. What's inside of me is the love of God. What's inside of me is the Spirit of the Father. What's inside of me is the Spirit of the Son. What's inside of me is the Spirit of the Holy Ghost. What's inside of me is the ways of God. He's written His laws and His ways upon the table of my heart, my mind, so that I will keep them, so that I will do them. All that stuff, it isn't my desires. When I got the wisdom and understanding that it's not my desires, it was a demonic desires, it became an entirely different issue. Now I wasn't dealing with something that I wanted or needed. I was dealing with something that was trying to be cast upon me, that Satan was trying to enslave me with, that I could point the finger and say, you devil of hell, you take your lust and you go now. It's a wonderful transition in your life. When you recognize that what's coming out of your heart is every good thing of the Holy Ghost, the treasures of heaven, the wellspring of life. Hallelujah. Perusate. And it has authority over everything. Hallelujah. It command your body to feel good when you feel bad and obey when you're thinking about being disobedient. Huh? Listen, you tell me, listen tell me, to me just a minute. Understand that the body without the spirit is dead. Praise God for the Holy Ghost that's come dwelling in my body. Amen. And bringing life and quickening me, making me alive. You give God the Holy Ghost full and absolute dominion and authority of your life. You give Christ Jesus clear, sovereign, absolute, undivided authority over your life. You give Father God absolute authority over your life to where you belong to Him and only Him. He's got the receipt of purchase. And the receipt of purchase that He's purchased you is that you have the Holy Ghost, because He's not giving the Holy Ghost to anybody that He hasn't purchased. Because it's sacred. It is the receipt of purchase. It's the proof. It's the guarantee that God bought you and that you belong to Him. Real quickly, Romans chapter 6 says, what should we say then? Should we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin, that's cut off from sin? Hallelujah. Isn't that wonderful? It's the reverse of what happened to Adam. In the day you shall surely die. He was spiritually cut off in that day and cast out. People want to make and believe that the disobedience of Adam is greater in effect than the obedience of Christ Jesus. And I tell you, Romans chapter 5 does not teach that doctrine. I'm going to tell you again, Romans chapter 5 does not teach that doctrine. Romans chapter 5 that built us up this moment teaches the doctrine rather that the obedience of Christ Jesus is greater in its effect than the disobedience of Adam, and it abounds unto all men. Hallelujah. Praise God. Anybody who's going to receive. God forbid, how shall we... God forbid, how shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Don't you understand that as many of you that were baptized in Christ were baptized into His death? Hallelujah. Say, I am crucified with Christ.
I am crucified with Christ.
Say, I am buried with Him by baptism into His death.
I am buried with Him by baptism.
What happens to you after you get buried and dead? Huh? Do you just rot? No, you get raised up together with Him. Praise God. Amen. Hallelujah. Say, I'm raised up together with Him. So Paul says, if you'd then be risen with Christ in Colossians chapter 3. Amen. What are you supposed to be doing? Seeking those things which are above. What are those things? What are those things which are above? Christ Jesus sitting upon the right hand of the Father. What is He doing? Pouring out all of His goodness and all of His grace by the Holy Ghost so that we find ourselves in every dimension walking in the blessings and the goodness of God's life and nature. Hallelujah. So we therefore being buried with Him by baptism in His death, like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so also you walk in newness of life. I'm in the resurrection life. The resurrection has authority over me. And the resurrection alone. Christ Jesus has authority over me. Him alone. Satan has no power over me. Satan cannot touch me. Say, Satan can't touch me.
Satan can't touch me.
Because that's what the Bible said. We know that everyone who is born of God doesn't sin, keeps himself, and the wicked one can't touch him. Somebody said, that isn't a reality. Well, let it be a reality. It may not be a reality to you, but it's a reality to God because the truth of God's word proclaimed it. You can look at what happens with a man who's got a hedge about him, Job. What happens to you and me when we're baptized in the hedge? There's no scripture in the Bible that tells that God that Job was baptized in the hedge, that Job was a new creation. filled with the Spirit of God and then baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. And that he had a wellspring and rivers. But you do. I think that maybe we might find Job having taken far more advantage of all of those gifts and all of those graces, that they would have become more valuable. What happened is, the trick is this: Satan creates within the culture of this world where everything else must be more valuable to you, so you have to prioritize God and leave all the things that actually would give to you and supply to you far more than anything that this culture and the way and the framework of society could provide for you. That your idea of taking care of yourself is far inferior to what God would do if you would allow him to fully take care of you, so that it's constantly running interference with the blessings of God in your life because you're too busy with all the other stuff. But Father said, you seek me, you make my kingdom first, you seek my righteousness first, everything, I'll give it all to you, far more than what Solomon had, far more than what you see when you see that how I provided for the field, for the grass of the field and the flower thereof. So, Father's amazing. Why don't you just go ahead and prove him? Why don't you go test him out? He says... He does. He even allows us to do that. He says, take me test for test drive. He basically does. He says, prove me. Prove me, therewith says the Lord, and see if I won't bless you. He's an amazing God. Look at this. He's trying to help us to understand what to allow to have authority over our lives and what not to allow to have authority, what to give place to and what not to give place to. He says, for we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. And literally, it's we have been planted together in the likeness of his death and are in the likeness of, and are in the resurrection, are in the resurrection. And we're talking about the spiritual resurrection. The likeness is just is an assumed phrase. So just, we're in the resurrection. Pretty radical, isn't it? Knowing this first. You got to get this first. Your old man got killed. D-E-A-D, dead. D-dead. D-double dead. 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 Who is now alive? Who is alive now? Jesus is alive. He raised up, dead didn't raise, dead man, dead old man didn't raise. Dead old man's dead, crucified together with Christ. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with Christ, the body of sin might be destroyed. Hold your finger there. I just want to show you something real quickly. I'll show you something real quickly in Colossians. Just hold your finger there. Just show you something real quickly in Colossians. Please, quickly. Colossians, where are you at? Colossians chapter 2. Go over to Colossians chapter 2 and look with me right here at verse 11. He says, in whom also you were circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, in the putting off of the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. The circumcision of Christ is the same as the new creation. It's the same as the new nature. It's the miracle of the covenant. The body of sin is destroyed. Why empower it anymore? Why give it authority anymore? So Paul, go back with me to Romans chapter 6 and look at what Paul says. He says, for he that is dead is freed from sin. Say, I'm freed.
I'm freed.
I'm freed from it. I'm not the slave to it anymore. I'm not under its bondage. For the law of the spirit of life, or the spiritual laws of life that are in Christ Jesus, have made me free from the law of sin and death. I'm not going to get to Romans chapter 8 tonight. But it's the great shout out at the end of Romans chapter 7. Look here in verse 8, now if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dies no more. Death has no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. Likewise, reckon yourself also to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let not sin therefore reign. Have no authority have no dominion in your mortal bodies, that you should obey it in the lust thereof, neither yield you your members as instruments or weapons of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as weapons or instruments of righteousness unto God, for sin shall have no authority over you. For sin shall have no dominion. Or for sin shall have no power. Or for sin shall have no right over you. For you are not under the law, but you have been liberated, you under grace. What then shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? God forbid. What is grace? Grace is the means by which you and I were made a new creation, given a new heart, and given a new spirit. This is the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the faith that made us righteous. But God, know ye not, verse 16, know ye not that to whom you yield yourself servants to obey, his servants you are, to whom you obey. If you obey sin, then you are the servants of death. And if you obey righteousness, then you are the servants of God. But God be thanked that ye were once servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart this form of doctrine which was delivered to you, being then made free from sin. Ye became the servants or slaves of righteousness. I have believed with the heart unto righteousness. I did not believe with my heart unto unrighteousness. I believed with my heart unto righteousness. Hallelujah. Because I believe in my heart that God raised Jesus from the dead. And those two are equated by God. Being now made free from sin, you are the servants of righteousness. I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your human understanding. For as ye have yielded your members servants to uncleanness and to iniquity, unto iniquity, even now yield your members servants to righteousness unto holiness. Say, I'm yielding myself. I'm coming under the authority. I am only going to be servant to the only thing that will have mastery over me. The only thing that's telling me what to do is righteousness. And what's going to result in my life is the activities of God's own divine presence, which is holiness. Amen. For when ye were the servants of sin, ye were free from righteousness. What fruit then have ye in those things wherein you are now ashamed? For the end of them are death. But now being made free from sin, praise God. How many times you got to say it? In one chapter. And why do people have blinders on when they read Romans chapter 7 after having read this so many times? They're going to crawl over top of sin has no more dominion. You not the servants of sin. You've been freed from it. And then because they don't understand what Paul is doing when he's basically speaking of the way his life used to function under the law, they want to go ahead and instead confess, it's sin that dwelleth in me. No, it's God that dwelleth in me, and he's not the minister of sin. Hallelujah. Is Christ Jesus then the minister of sin? God forbid. Amen. I want you to hear it. And I believe that this is the greatest wisdom that anybody could ever have. For the wages of sin is death. If you could just get enough wisdom to recognize that whatever it is you're about to do is going to create death and destruction. Death and destruction. I'm going to give them a piece of my mind. It's probably the last piece you're going to have. Oh, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to rise up and defend myself because I'm tired of being made a doormat. I'm going to tell you, you're going to lose you to God's, the defense that God has given you. I'd rather have God's defense any day and be treated like a doormat. I'd rather have the things that only God can give and that he supplies. I'd rather commit my way unto him. I'd rather let him be the revenger of all such things. Vengeance are mine, says the Lord, says I, this is mine. It's not your department. Your department, sit there and love and be nice. But Lord, I don't want to. I would like to be part of the vengeance right now. I feel it. I feel it. See, God says you deny yourself, daily deny yourself. If I could get you, if you can understand that the church is the place where you come to learn to walk in righteousness, if I can get you to understand that, if I can get God's people to understand that you come to the church to learn how to walk in righteousness, to learn how to hook up with the Holy Ghost, who's the teacher of righteousness, the empower of righteousness. If we could get you to understand that we're here for the purpose of helping you to understand a practical relationship walk with the Lord Jesus Christ and with the Holy Ghost. If you just come understand what it means to daily deny yourself. If you want to be his disciple, to daily deny yourself, and will you'll allow us to show you you.
That's right.
And say, we don't like it. Can we do that? We don't like you. We're tired of you. Huh?
That's good.
Now, I'm offended. You should not like you in that sense.
Right.
We speak in stronger terms. We deny you. The Lord says, deny yourself. Huh?
That's right.
Somebody said, he said, I'm glad I'm not you. I can't believe it. The preacher is supposed to walk in the love of God. He said, I'm glad I'm not you. I'm glad I'm not me either.
Amen.
I'm glad that this life is given over to Jesus.
Amen.
For me to live as Christ Jesus. That means I'm giving him all authority and dominion. I want you to do that. I want you to stand with me. Hallelujah. 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 Ishebronasaya. Ilimigaya shuba. Iborosoraniya pai. Hallelujah. Kurusombrosane. Now, Father, we desire to have our eyes opened so that we might understand this wonderful fellowship that you've made possible for each one of us. We ask you, Father, that our eyes be open, O God, that we may more fully cooperate with you, Holy Spirit. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that every heart and mind and life will be so yielded to you that they're constantly getting explosions of joy.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Father, I pray, God, in Jesus' name, that nuclear blast of divine love is going off on the inside of them. Father, I pray, God, in Jesus' name, that they get so filled up with you that they fit for the battle. You know, you only got to have a problem with spiritual warfare when you're getting beat up, when you're getting knocked upside the head and thrashed around, thrown all over the place. But when you're strong in the strength of the Lord and power of his might, it's turned around, and you having some fun. Amen. Hallelujah. You're dealing with a thing that needs to be dealt with, and what's the result? Breakthrough. Hallelujah. What's the result? Liberation for the lost. What's the result? The blessings and supply of God flowing freely. You're not having a bad time. Oh, we in the midst of spiritual warfare. You didn't say that. Oh, we in the midst of spiritual warfare because you're getting yourself, you beat up. I was about to say you're getting your bee kicked. You're behind kicked. Oh, you spiritual warfare. Oh, we in spiritual warfare. Yeah, you're getting beat up. But if you're strong in the strength of the Lord and power of his might, you're doing the beating up.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
The breakthrough is yours. The provision of heaven, the supply of God is yours. Satan's never won one match with God. Not one match. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's not won one round. He's sutaraya. He's not won a single war. I said he's not won a single battle.
Amen.
Not one. God is the undefeated champion of heaven and of earth. Ko rishikaya punanai. And he's inside of me. Greater is he that's in me than he's in the world. Somebody said, we're going to have to sin more or less every day. No power, hell, Satan, and devil, demons. Hey, when did you read? Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Did you read that? Now then you need to understand what's in the world and what's in you. Don't put what's in the world in you. Believe not every spirit. Try the spirits, for many false prophets have gone out into the world. Everyone who confessed that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. He that does not confess that Jesus is come in the flesh is not of God. Hereby we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. And our little children, you have overcome him. For greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. So guess what? You're confessing that Jesus Christ came in the flesh in respect to your life too. Not just that he came in the flesh 2,000 years ago when he was born of a virgin named Mary in a town in Bethlehem in Judea in the nation of Israel. But he's come into your life too. For then you say, this is the spirit of truth. We know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. The spirit of truth says, greater is he that is in me. Christ has come in me. Christ, he lives in me. Christ, Jesus. Lord Jesus, I'm tired of having control and having a bummed out situation around here. I know you're tired of living around in all this heaviness and sorrow and problems and issues, and I've not been providing very well. Lord, a good habitation for you to be in. And Lord, I just ask you now, go ahead and take over, because you do a fine job. You do a better job. You, Lord Jesus, you were anointed with the oil of joy above all the others around you, and you're in me. So take control now of my spirit. Take control of my emotions and my appetites, every dimension of my life. Take control of my mind and my understanding, my evaluations, my thinker, my believer. Be faith in me. Be strength in me. Be the power of God at work in me, that the excellency of the power and the glory may be of you and not of me. Be like a wellspring. Be like a river. Be like the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. Be the overcomer. Be the life giver. Be the counselor. Be all that you, God, alone can be. Be in me. Take control. Rule me. I come under your authority. I submit myself to nothing else. John G. Lake so stepped into the reality of it. When he was in South Africa, he was so built up in faith, with such abandonment in faith, because he bought a one-way ticket, basically, to go to the mission field. And they were having him, people were dying right and left, falling off like flies in the wintertime from the plague. And he said, put the plague on me. As soon as it touches me, it'll die, because I'm the temple of the living God. And my whole being is so filled with life, no death has power over me. Oh, that a whole army of people of God would so step in to such a relationship, so coming under the authority and the mandate of heaven. The sickness has no hold on you. My Uncle Virgil, he's in heaven right now, and he wrote a song. He said, sickness has no hold on me. I'm seated in heavenly places. By his stripes I'm healed, you see. I'm seated in heavenly places. Sin? No, it hath no hold on me. I'm seated in heavenly places. I crushed his head at Calvary. I'm seated in heavenly places. He said, the song went on and said, living word transforming me. I'm seated in heavenly places. Sons of God to maturity. I'm seated in heavenly places. And he'd make the organ get up, move around. Such a psalmist. They're just singing in heaven right now, in the choir, around the throne. Won't be long, and you and I will take our places there. And all that we've done in terms of cooperating and participating with the Holy Ghost will be all that mattered. How much money you made, the house you lived in, the car you drove, the clothes you had, the people you knew, your connections, whatever, won't matter nothing. All that will matter was what you've done, what you participated with in the realms of the kingdom of God in this life. That would have been all that mattered. You look back on your life. I'm not going to look back on my life and say I could have done more. I told Ann and I were flying back from Asia one day. We were worn out. We were a slap. We'd been to South Korea. We'd been to Japan. We'd been to Nepal, southern Nepal, 120 degrees. It's crazy. We were just worn out. I said, baby, we cannot run the risk of laying down our lives, breathing out our last breath, rather. We cannot take the risk of breathing out our last breath and saying we could have done more. If I hadn't have been distracted with this thing, we could have done more. If I hadn't been so busy at work, could have done more. If I hadn't been overwhelmed with this problem, could have done more. If I hadn't had unforgiveness in my life, could have done more. If I hadn't had doubt in my life, could have done more. If I just believed God, could have done more. We're not going to do that. I'm not going to run the risk saying I could have done more. I'm going to say, I fought the fight. I've run the race. Ha. Henceforth is laid up for me a crown of life which shall not fade away. I want every person in this place to be able to understand the insight and the wisdom that God has given me to look at myself laying on my deathbed, getting ready to breathe out my last breath, getting ready to leave this world and go into the next. I want you to understand the same kind of insight about your life so that you'll say from this day forward, I'm pouring out my life like a drink offering upon the altar of the living God. Maybe you're a person that's listening to me on the web. Maybe, you know, maybe you live out in the middle of the wilderness up in Montana. You don't even have a car. You don't have a means to do anything. I'm telling you right now, you've got knees. You can get down on your knees and you begin to devote your life to prayer, to crying out to God, to receiving those understandings that only come out of the realms of the Holy Ghost. You begin to change things around you. You can begin to change the world around you with a passionate prayer and supplication by the Holy Spirit. No one's left out of this. I mean, God's not going to have everybody go stand upon a platform with thousands and tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands of people before them. That's a special anointing. People go try to do it and, you know, come on, give me a break. You do it, you've got an anointing to do it. There's a miracle anointing. There's signs and wonders, miracle anointing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Tim's going to be here. Tim Hall will be here on Wednesday. He's a model of that anointing. Carlos Anacondi is a model of that anointing. Reinhard Bonnke is a model of that anointing. And I've got a list of other people model that anointing. Not everybody's going to do that. But God's got a call for you. He's got a ministry for you. And he wants you to just pour your life out to that call and that ministry. Just pour your heart out. Hold nothing back. Hold nothing back. You be faithful in the things Father has given you to do now. And he'll promote you later. Don't run out ahead. One night we seen great signs and wonders and miracles and just amazing things. And someone came to me and said, where did you get this anointing? I said, standing in the place, in the church, worshiping Jesus. Just standing there, obeying God, wanting only him. Yes. Faithfully doing the things that he gave me to do. That's where I got this anointing. Hallelujah. That's where I got, really what we're saying is that's where I got this participation with the Holy Ghost, because he's the one that's doing it. It's not like it comes out of our self realm, as it were. Hallelujah. It's Christ Jesus going everywhere with us because we've come to know him. Amen. You just do it in your life. Don't run sickness off. Get ferocious with sickness, disease. Don't allow it. If you want to come into divine health, Father, let you come into divine health. It can't be mandated. It's relationship driven. God has divine health for you. He's got divine provision for you. He's got everything that you need. He wishes above all things that you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. I mean, we've just been given it all. Thank you, Jesus. Don't compare yourself with other people. Just look to Jesus and say, Lord, I'm yours. That's all you got to do. Father will put so big on the inside of you those things that he's willed that it'd be impossible for you to refuse. Should you be willing,
Father will put so big on the inside of you those things that He's willed for you to do that it will be impossible for you to refuse if you're willing. Father will put on the inside of you those things that He wills for you to do that will be impossible for you to refuse should you be willing. There's no need to feel bad about yourself anymore because you've given up on self-evaluation. There's no bad reason to feel bad about yourself anymore because you're denying it anyways. For you to live as Jesus is going to be all about Jesus from this here on out. It's all going to be about the life of Christ from here on out. Not going to be like, oh, wretched man that I am anymore. Who shall deliver me from this body of sin? For ye have been circumcised with the circumcision of Christ and the removal of the body of sins. Guess what? Same author. Hallelujah. Same author. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Prosekiah. Ha! The liberating, God-given gift of new and abundant and divine life. Oh, that is full of everything that belongs to the glory and the goodness of the living God who loves us so much. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth that every soul standing in this building tonight would come under the authority of your word and of your spirit, that all other things would be deemed by them as lies. And they refuse them and yield their members only to you. From this day forward, to live by your word and live by your spirit. To walk out your life, to be led by you, Holy Spirit. To allow Jesus Christ to be revealed in all the beauty and the splendor of His love and His humility and His goodness and His meekness and His power. His authority. Lord, we turn our lives over to you. Rise up, O God, in me. Rise up, O God, in me. Arise in me, O God. Arise on me, rise in me, O God, and let your enemies be scattered. Ha. Rise in me, O God, and go before us and subdue all our enemies, O God. We pray in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Ha ha. Hallelujah. Just let me just tell you this. I you know what? I found this place of living where all I desire is Jesus. Where all I want is this relationship with Him. He has everything that I need. I find myself complete in Him. I'm so filled up, so full of all that He has given, I don't have room for anything else. And I pray that Jesus' name, that you'll find rest, that you won't be under the obligation of performance, and you got to get this done, and you got to do the other thing, and you got to be this, and you got to be that. But you just find yourself just so in love with Jesus, so filled up with Him. Lord, I'm so captivated by you. I find all my life in you. Just live there, live worshiping Him and praising Him and giving thanks. And when things look bad, turn your face towards Jesus and thank Him for His goodness and His faithfulness. And the things of this earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Just turn your eyes upon Jesus, no matter where you're at, no matter what the place, no matter what the circumstance, whatever it is that comes and tries to rule you, whatever it is that tries to come take authority over you, whatever it is that tries to come and mandate some other opinion to you, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Turn. 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 Your eyes upon Jesus and look full in his wonderful grace, and the things of this world will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. You have to be willing to do it. God will not make you do it. He'll say, turn and see, turn and behold, turn and look. Look and live. But you can't be stiff-necked. You can't walk in your denominational doctrines. You cannot walk in your personal opinions and preferences and ideas and thoughts and philosophies and ideologies about God. Just turn your heart over to him now. Just be loved by him now. Come and know and believe the love that God has for you. God is love. He that dwells in God dwells in love. Herein is our love made perfect, fully matured. Husbands, be thankful for your wives. Let them know it. Bless them. Kiss them a lot. Hug them. Wives, be thankful for your husbands. Be blessed by them. Once again, return the favor of the kisses and the hugs. Be a blessing to one another. Serve one another as you serve the Lord Jesus. Children, love your parents. Obey them. Parents, love your kids. Don't provoke them. Be a blessing to them. Lay hands on them every day and believe God that they'll do far more than you've ever done, be far more than you've ever been, that the double blessing, the triple blessing, the Holy Ghost unlimited blessing come upon them. You brothers, you sisters, extended family members, the household of faith, walking in the love of God and being filled with the love of God is not some mystical state of meditation. It is a living, active participation where you hug people, you bless people, you do stuff for folks, you show them right heart and right attitude. So I pray in Jesus' name, you'll want to keep yourself in the love of God from here on out. That you'll keep yourself in that place of knowing the love of Christ which passes knowledge, and know there you'll be filled with all those fullness. Knowing that God is somebody who's going to come and reward you. There's going to be a blessing. There's going to be a fruit. There's going to be a result to obeying him, doing what he's called you to do. Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Well, listen, I don't ever want anyone to leave the building without worshiping the Lord through tithes and offerings. It's what God has commanded. It's not what I have need of. It's not what the building has need of. It's not what the bills have need of. It's what Father has need of. I don't want it to be convoluted in your mind. I want it to be holy. I want it to be sacred to you. And I want you also to realize that there's a miracle in it for you. It's not a loss to you. When you start hearing something like, oh my goodness, we don't have any money, and we have to go to church tonight, we got to pay, then you need to come out against that thing in the mighty name of Jesus, and that just and rebuke it and resist it steadfast in the faith. Because Father's going to work a miracle through every act of obedience. He is a rewarder of those who believe him, who do what he says to do, who seek him. Jesus' name. So come worship the Lord with your tithes and offerings, and then find a bunch of people around you, hug them, tell them that you love them, bless them. Amen. Listen, I want you to remember, always do this. Always prepare an offering for the Lord. It doesn't have to be big. It doesn't have to be big. It's not about the size of it. Remember the widow with two mites? It wasn't the size of it that was valuable to the Lord. It was the meaning of it. Somebody says, well, all I have is 25 cents to my name. You really need to give that 25 cents desperately. You mean you're going to take the widow's last two mites? You're going to take the person's last 25 cents? Yeah, absolutely. We're going to take your last little bit of oil and your last little bit of flour because we want to see the blessings of God multiplied to you. And Father's faithful. You hook up with a miracle and it's going to happen. Everybody knows I'm not a money preacher. I'm a faith preacher. I'm talking about the miracle for you. I'm talking about the miracle supply for you. Amen. I don't want you to forget this. How many of you are not going to be forgetful of yours? Because what happens is you come and you begin to hook up in faith and you bring whatever it is that God, that you have. Whatever it is that you have. Doesn't mean it's not, once again, it's not the quantity. Whatever it is you have. You're hooking up with in faith with us. You're hooking up in faith with Father. You're hooking up in faith for the miracle as you walk in obedience to Him and as you honor Him. I'm going to honor Him. Say, He's worthy of honor.
He's worthy of honor.
And I'm going to honor Him. Amen. So if you want greater dimension of love flowing through your life, find somebody, hug them. Participate with love. You want a greater dimension of miracles working through your life? Pray for the sick. Pray for those who are in need of a miracle. Yeah, that's just the way it works. You want a greater dimension of joy in your life? Just practice being happy more. Hallelujah. Just be that's what I do when I'm not feeling the overwhelming joy of the Lord. I just bow So I said, what do you do if you don't feel the joy? You pray in the Holy Ghost till the joy comes. Is that simple or what? What if you don't feel the peace? Pray in the Holy Ghost till the peace comes. And then, what if you don't feel the love? You feel in the, what do you do? Pray in the Holy Ghost until the love comes. Hug somebody too. That's true. Participate. Participate with the anointing. Hallelujah. Listen, if anybody is sick in your body, if you're sick in your body, we'll pray for you and we'll command that sickness to go. In Jesus' name. Nobody leave out of here sick. If you're watching by the web and you have sickness in your body, some kind of a flu, out! Out! Fuera! And in Jesus' name, in nombre de Jesus Cristo. Hallelujah. Out in Jesus' name. Leave your body. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father, for the miracle. Ambro barbe vecchi che donno non mamando le lode per tirare saia. Hurra ba 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 ba. Hurra ba 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 ba. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Kuri dara masateri din kapasateli manal oposutaha. Oh, God. Father, we thank you for the anointing. We thank you for your mighty provision. We thank you, Father God, that sickness and disease has no power over us. We don't have to live an achy, depressed, miserable life. But we get to live an abundant life, filled up with every good thing that comes from heaven. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Let Jesus touch you now. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Sickness, go out your body. Out of your body. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name, anybody dealing with stomach flu, anything like that, we'll pray over you. You've got to go. That old foul thing. Be healed in Jesus' name. Be healed. Be healed. Be healed in Jesus' name. What's up? From the crown of your head, the soles of your feet. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Membros assist. Membros assist. Membros assist. Membros assist. Membros assist. Just be filled up now. Be strengthened now in your spirit. Be strengthened right now in your spirit and your body. Be strengthened. Huh. Hallelujah. Just be filled. Be filled up. Be filled. Be filled with every good thing. Be filled with every good thing. Be filled. Be filled with every good thing. Filled. What's up? How are you doing? You doing okay? Are you feeling good? You just want some prayer? Lord Jesus, we pray right now in the name, in your mighty name, we ask you to touch Josiah right now. Right now, right now, just fill him with your goodness, fill him with your presence, fill him with all the wonderful things of heaven. Strengthen his little body to stand against sickness and disease, his little spirit to hate evil and love righteousness, and his mother too. Amen. Hallelujah. What's up? You know, I see a lot of change going on in you. You've been being renewed day by day. You've been going from glory to glory, you know that? Strength to strength. Hallelujah. Kadesh. Lane the monga say, I tell you. Right in the monge. Right, I mess it down. In the name of Jesus. In the name of the book of the state. Father, I just thank you that right now in Jesus' name, that Brittany's going to be able to enjoy a greater expression of the flow of the Holy Ghost. There's nothing so exciting as the flow of the Holy Ghost. Just be patient with yourself. Give yourself to the things of the Spirit, and that explosion and demonstration of the Spirit of the living God will come with greater force, will come with greater authority through your life, will come with greater expression, with greater demonstration. Hallelujah. Be confident, be steadfast in the things that you're going after God for, because he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him.
Hallelujah. He's here with you and you know it. Without faith, it's impossible to please God, because they that come to God must believe that He's here. He's existing. He exists. Amen. And that He's going to give the things, supply the things that He's promised and declared in His Word. That means a rewarder of those who seek Him. Amen. Hallelujah. Steadfastly, not letting up. Amen. Knowing with confidence, knowing with great confidence about those things that Father has promised. Hallelujah. He's working them, doing them, supplying them, developing us in every good thing. Hallelujah. So that He can express a greater dimension of His glory through our lives. Father, I pray Your blessing now in Jesus' name. Be blessed. Be blessed. Be happy. Be blessed. Be happy. Somebody say, well, how can I be happy when I have so much sorrow and problems and issues I'm having to deal with? Quit looking at the sorrow and the problems and issues. Quit looking at them. But they're in my face. Well, then turn away. Look to heaven. Look to heaven. Just decide I'm just going to see Jesus. But you don't know what I'm going through. Doesn't matter. It works for every situation. It works if you're in the prison, being hung up, side down, by your ankles and beating the shins. It works. Listen, I know women in China, in Asia, who've been tortured and tormented for more than 15 years. Every day in prison, of every abuse you can think of. And they're full of the Holy Ghost. Come on, think about that, people. Relativism, we try to look at, you know, we think about it, we think about the terms of what we've been through. Come on. There's no exclusion from what God has promised. All we have to do is just say, okay, I'm not gonna live into the prison of it anymore. I'm not gonna live in the problem of it anymore. Darlene would be here on the 22nd. On the 22nd of March. She was tortured for many years in prison. Look at her. She's full of the Holy Ghost. Look, she's been marked up, scarred up, tattooed with prison numbers. There's so many people who've been through so. Look, I know we're going, different people have different things going through. It's hard. It's like you can say, well, I've not been in this and that in prison, but you don't understand it. Listen, God understands. All I'm saying is that it works in one place, it'll work in another place. Look at Jesus. Just look to Jesus. Look to Him. Look and live. In Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Rise up and walk. Just open up your eyes and look. Just see Him. He loves you as much as He loves anyone else. He's going to take care of you just as good as He's taking care of anyone else. I promise you. Tell me, what do you want? Okay. Well, what do you want? Those things are yours.
They're yours. They belong to you. This sweater belong to you? This thing's belong to you just like that sweater belongs to you right there. It's yours. Jesus' name. Be healed. Be healed. Be healed. Where's the rest of your family at? Where's the rest of your children?
Upstairs.
They're upstairs. Father, touch the family in Jesus' name. Oh, household. Hey. Actually, I wasn't talking to Kate. You can come if you want, but I know I was looking in your direction. I'm doing good, man. I'm just so blessed to see you here.
Yeah, I got my car stolen like a week ago or so, so that's why I can't come to every meeting.
Somebody stole your car?
Yeah.
You got here and they stole your car?
Yeah.
The bros jacked your car?
Yeah. Yeah. Car.
I guess you didn't need that car.
No, I'm doing just fine.
Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In the name of Most High God. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' mighty name. Petros mind cap. Esetitalum. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father, for the anointing of the Holy Ghost that liberates and frees us from every hold of darkness and every hold of circumstance and situations and experiences, so that we may walk with you. Father, thank you for strengthening your servant, Gustavo. In his inner being to walk with you, to serve you. In Jesus' name. Man, we're just so glad to see you back here. Satan, I hate you. And I destroy your work and I render all your activities powerless. Don't mess with Gustavo.
Just took one service. I was doing some stuff that was really heavy. And I looked at my mom and was like, you know what, Mom? It's over. I'm done with it. I came on Wednesday night and I cried for like 1 hour, but that service changed my life. No more addictions, nothing was broken. And like everyone's like, we should put you in a drug program for like 90 days, 60 days. Like, no, it was done. That service on
Thank
Wednesday.
You, Jesus.
That was the first service. This is my third service. I'm feeling good. Like, no
Hallelujah.
No weight on me. I'm feeling wonderful.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Yeah. For the first time in my life, I'm feeling wonderful.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Yeah. And I'm Thank very you. Happy.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Yeah. Well, for the first time since you've been back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I lost everything completely.
I understand. Well, I told you.
Yeah.
I told you.
And I feel great.
I told you, though. I told you, if you listen and you went and did those things, these things were going to happen.
And they did happen.
And they did happen.
And I was like, no, let me go back.
Yeah.
And that's why I called you. Because yeah. People were like, no, come to my church. Or come. I was like, no, I'm going to Pastor Mark's church because I know where it's at. And it was like, everyone had like little disco lights and all that. No. I was like, no, this ain't helping.
The disco lights ain't helping, man. They had a great light show, but it wasn't working. Well, we love you, man. We love you very much.
Thank you, Pastor.
We love you very much. Hallelujah. Little man, what would you like tonight? What's been happening? What's been troubling your spirit? Anything been going on? Big heavies? Huh? Any big burdens? Any issues? Huh? You want to really learn how the Lord wants you to walk with Him? No troubles. Dad's got it all under control. He's not worried one little bit about the bills or the milk or the food or anything else. Yeah. Jesus' name I pray. Faith fuels your heart. Faith. Supernatural. Miraculous. God supplying faith. Now, and that is that, David, this is you and your family's last service, right? Oh, Wednesday night, we get you Wednesday night. Praise God. Is everybody healthy here? Sick free? Is this a sick free zone? Disease free zone? Man, it is great living in the zone. Eh? Disease-free zone, no stomach aches, no stuff. Hey? Father, I thank you for your protection. Father, I thank you for your love, your hand of grace and mercy, that as David and Heather step out to be used more by you, to just make themselves that much more available. They don't have to have any fear in their heart, nor concern, nor worry. And Father God, we thank you that they also be very sensitive to your direction. And hurry back. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, we thank you for working great miracles. No, we just want the Lord to have his will. Have his way. Sikatainos prafadeo. So Toradivra, strengthen these guys. Strengthen the bros, Lord. To be confident in you. To be strong in you. To be right heart and right spirit and right countenance. In Jesus' name. So they look like the king's seed. They have the countenance of the king's seed. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Look at me. In Jesus' name. Sari. Atokunosia. Haraburde. Hextilana mondadea. Likoromosa. Just lift your hands towards heaven, baby. Look up here at me. Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus.